morning.
Morning.
Welcome to St. Mark United Methodist Church in Hamilton, New Jersey. I'm Pastor Bob Lawrence, and it's my joy to welcome both those in the sanctuary this day, as well as those who are online. Just a couple little announcements. Over the past week, a number of you have asked regarding church envelopes for January and February. We've contacted the company. They have traced where these are. They were mailed out the middle of December. But they have traced them, and they're sitting in the local post office. The post office has been overwhelmed since the time of the election and are very far behind. We do have some individual envelopes in the narthex that you can use from week to week until those church envelopes come. Thank you for your patience. Again, there's not a whole lot we can do until the post office catches up. A reminder, next Sunday is Human Relations Day. There are special envelopes in the narthex for your use. Thank you for your support of Human Relations Day in the United Methodist Church. Having made these announcements, we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Join in our call to worship as is printed on the screen. God's voice calls over the waters. God's voice thunders over the face of the deep.
Give glory to our God.
God's word is strong. God's word shatters the cedars of Lebanon.
Behold the splendor of our God.
God's spirit unleashes fiery flames. God's spirit shakes the wilderness.
Let the earth tremble before our God. Here in this place shout glory to our God.
Come, let us worship.
And our hymn is When Jesus Came to Jordan.
Thank you.
We pray together.
Father in heaven, at the baptism of Jesus in the river Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Grant that all who are baptized in his name may keep the covenant they have made and boldly confess him as Lord and Savior, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
Now we enter a time of silence. Hear the words and the thoughts of your people, O God, and hear us as we join together in that prayer which Jesus taught.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our first scripture lesson comes from the 19th chapter of the book of Acts. While Apollos was in Corinth, Paul passed through the interior regions and came to Ephesus, where he found some disciples. He said to them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became
They answered, into John's baptism. Paul said, John baptized with the baptism of repentance, telling the people to believe in the one who was to come after him, that is, in Jesus. When hearing this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When Paul has laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke in tongues and prophecies. Altogether, there were about 12 of them.
In our hymn is baptized in water.
Our second scripture this day is from the Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter, and I'll be reading verses 4 through 11. John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you, I am well pleased." Scripture can be a challenge. As we begin today, we have to set aside all thinking about in worship over the last 4 to 6 weeks. We do a reset or a redo as we enter the Gospel of Mark. For you see, Mark has none of the characters and none of the events of the Nativity mentioned in his Gospel. There's no angels or shepherds. No mention of Mary and Joseph. No mention of Simeon and Anna. No magi, no star, no flight to Egypt. No childhood reference to Jesus. There is no discussion of the account of Jesus' birth in the Gospel of Mark. Mark has Jesus come onto the scene, enter stage right. In the wilderness. He, like so many others, seek to encounter John and to be baptized. Now we could ask, why does Jesus need baptism? Or what does Jesus need to repent of? In Mark, it's clear that Jesus experiences all that which humans experience. And thus it's important that he joins the masses in seeking out the baptism of John. Jesus here is immersed in the human experience. In Mark, Jesus, through his baptism, is immediately prepared for temptation in the wilderness, followed by the beginning of his earthly ministry. Today we celebrate the baptism of our Lord Sunday, where annually we examine the baptism of Jesus and seek to explore together the mystery of the sacrament of baptism in our lives. I certainly do not seek to attempt in one sermon to unfold baptism and all of its mysteries. And I'll leave the heavy theology to persons more qualified than myself. But perhaps in just one Sunday sermon, we might be encouraged to open our minds and our lives to the richness of baptism. Have you ever felt that something must be missing? Have you ever wondered whether there had to be something more? Maybe a friend was telling you about a movie or a great book or an experience they had when they were out on vacation. They were so blown away by the experience that you have to check it out. Normally, that's a mistake. You see, you fall asleep in the movie that they thought was so great. You never get through the book that they thought was so wonderful. And you promise yourself that you never need to go back to the place that held so much charm for your friend. I hate to admit it, but I'm shallow. Cindy and I have decided that the more accolades that a movie gets, normally the less likely we are to enjoy it. Good Will Hunting, Cindy woke me up when the movie was over. Often what passes for entertainment passes us by or goes right over our heads. Have you ever had that same experience in terms of faith? You've heard people speak of their religious experience, and it's so vibrant, so fresh, and you know that they're just on fire for the experience that they had. You can't help but think that something is missing. You see, you come to church every Sunday, and those who come to church online come to church online every Sunday. Well, we enjoy the music, we like seeing folks. We support the church financially. Maybe you agree to serve on a team. You participate in supporting missions. You read the Upper Room devotional each day. You practice the kind of Christianity that your parents and grandparents would be proud of. It's warm, nice, steady, not too demanding. But you'd probably not describe yourself as being on fire. What's missing? Missing ingredients can make all the difference in the world. If you're making bread and you realize you don't have any yeast, whoops. Maybe you, like me, have worked for hours on a jigsaw puzzle, only to find one or more than one piece is missing. It's aggravating. Or you carefully lay out a project to be completed, only to discover that there are pieces called for in the instruction manual that are just not there. Conversation about baptism puts us smack in the middle of a theological battleground and debate that has challenged the church since its inception. There seem to be more questions than answers about baptism. Is it appropriate to baptize infants? Should people be rebaptized later in life? Is immersion the preferred method of baptism? Is a separate baptism of the Holy Spirit required for salvation? Is speaking in tongues a necessary sign of the baptism of the Spirit? Persons of genuine Christian faith honestly disagree regarding these questions. In terms of the United Methodist Church, we do practice infant baptism as a sign of God's prevenient grace in the life of a child. We do not believe in rebaptism and the practice of sprinkling, pouring, or immersion are all equally fine methods of baptism. We do not believe that speaking in tongues is a mandatory universal sign of baptism of the Spirit. John the Baptist witnesses to one who would come after him, who would baptize not only with water, but with the Spirit. In our gospel lesson, at the time of Jesus' baptism, the clouds open up. A dove comes out of the heavens, declaring to Jesus, "You are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased." Now, baptism for us seems like a fairly mild ritual. A cute baby, an adoring family, a few drops of water with pictures following the service. But we can't help but wonder whether anyone or anything changes. Is there something missing? In this account of Jesus' baptism, we have the heavens opening, a dive-bombing bird, the very voice of God. And all of this is to empower Jesus for the temptation and ministry that's going to follow. In fact, it follows in the very same first chapter of the Gospel of Mark. The presence of the Holy Spirit
hovers over the Jordan. And Mark tells us it's the Spirit that drives Jesus into the wilderness to experience temptation. Is there something missing? Could it be that we have unconsciously or consciously barred the doors of our lives from the working of the Holy Spirit? We've excluded the Spirit from being set loose in our lives, and yet we wonder why we don't experience the power that we believe is present in baptism and conversion. Just the thought that we're to be filled by the Holy Spirit scares us. Ephesians 5:28 reminds us that we're not to be filled with wine, but to be filled instead with the Holy Spirit. In our scripture lesson from Acts 19, we are introduced to Apollos. We are told that his background is he's from Alexandria. We're told he's eloquent, well-versed in scriptures. He's been instructed in the way of the Lord. He speaks with burning enthusiasm and accurately speaks of the things regarding Jesus. Sounds like Bud Pepper, right? Then there was only one thing missing. There was one hole in Apollos' theological instruction. He only knew about the baptism of John. He knew the baptism of repentance, but not the baptism of the Spirit promised by John with the arrival of Jesus. Priscilla and Aquila, leaders in the church at Ephesus, pull Apollos aside in chapter 18 and instruct him more clearly and accurately regarding baptism. Later, Paul visits Ephesus and comes across a group of disciples. But there seemed to be something missing in their understanding of the faith. Paul asks them, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" "We didn't know there was a Holy Spirit," they replied. After discovering they'd been baptized in the name of John rather than in the name of Jesus, this band of disciples were baptized. Paul laid hands on them, and the Holy Spirit comes and rests within them. Paul assures this band of 12 that the Spirit is not optional equipment for Christians. Let me say that again. The Spirit is not optional equipment for Christians. It's not like Bluetooth or cruise control. The presence of the Spirit is not an advanced degree separating Spirit-filled Christians from run-of-the-mill Christians. Last week we spoke of remembering our why. We reviewed our mission statement and reminded ourselves of the mission statement of the United Methodist Church, making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. You were encouraged to ask why. Why does the church do what it does? Why do you as individuals do what disciples do? Why? Today, this conversation regarding the Holy Spirit and baptism leads us to the question of how. How does the church do what it does? How do you do that in terms of being a disciple? The gift of the Holy Spirit bestowed on us in baptism and conversion, empowers us to be about the work of Christian discipleship. Have we opened ourselves to the fresh blowing of God's Holy Spirit? Have we committed ourselves to follow as the Holy Spirit leads us? If not, we're going to be left with a sense that something's missing. Let us pray. Gracious and glorious God, there are times where we're pretty sure that there's something missing within us. We try so hard, Lord, to do what would please you. We work harder and harder seeking to understand and seeking to live in a way that glorifies you. But Lord, as long as it's only what we do on our own, we're going to find something missing in our life. So gracious God, on this day in which we celebrate the baptism of our Lord and our baptism, we cry out that the Holy Spirit might come and fill this place and fill this people and empower us for the temptation that surely lies ahead and for the challenge of ministry that is before us. Lord, we come unto you, and we know we're unable on our own to bring healing, to change people's lives. But Lord, we believe you've called us to intercede. And so we pray for, Lord, for those who are suffering this day. We pray for families for whom this has been a horrendous week. We pray for those who need your touch of healing and grace. We need your presence and your touch in the lives of those experienced by COVID. Lord, we are reminded this week that we need you in our life as a nation. Lord, we need your healing for a country that's very clearly very torn apart. And we don't know how to fix it. But Lord, we ask that your Spirit might move through your church, through your people, to bring healing and hope and to bring us together. We pray, gracious God, for a broken world. Lord, asking that your Spirit might flow over the deep. Bring us together. Make us more committed to each other. Gracious God, we can't take the very next step in discipleship if not led, empowered, changed, encouraged by your Holy Spirit. So Lord, even that which it's hard for us to understand, you go ahead and do your work in us. In the name of Christ we pray.
Hymn is Breathe On Me, Breath Of God.
Breathe on me, breath of God. Fill me with life, God.
So go. You remember that was also last week. But don't go on your own. Go with the blessing and the knowledge of the Holy Spirit guiding you each step of the way. Go with the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.